Orson Welles Desconocido.
Stage illusionists. Their last great golden age came to an end with the last great days of the stage among magicians. There were giants in those days. That was when theater was theater, still beglamored and adazzle with theatricality. By way of homage to those grand old wonder workers, we're going to recreate for you a few moments of illusion in the high old style. Only the tricks will be new.
Uno de los trucos más famosos de Orson Welles, su silueta. ¿Un disfraz o una abstracción de sí mismo? ¿O simplemente un juego? Quizá el truco funcionase demasiado bien. El Orson Welles real desaparece detrás de su perfil, convirtiéndose en una sombra estilizada de sí mismo. Hacia el final de su vida se le calificó de genio consumido, de volcán apagado. El mito Welles estaba servido.
Ladies and gentlemen, I wouldn't fool you for the world.
...1975... 10 años antes de su muerte, Welles volvió a Hollywood. La American Film Association honra al hijo pródigo que vuelve a casa. Tras ser repudiado durante décadas, recibe un premio al conjunto de su obra. La carrera de Orson Welles despegó inmediatamente. Primero niño prodigio. Después director teatral de gran éxito en Nueva York. Y a continuación, escandaloso mago de la radio. A los 23 años era escritor, director, actor, periodista y una gran estrella. Entonces llegó a Hollywood. A los 25 años se hizo famoso en todo el mundo con Ciudadano Kane. Pero el prodigio era difícil de aceptar. Para Hollywood era demasiado extravagante, rebelde, excéntrico. En Estados Unidos no había más trabajo para él, por lo que partió hacia el exilio en Europa. Pero los productores europeos también empezaron a darle la espalda. Cada vez era más difícil producir. Las pocas obras que terminó fueron alabadas por los críticos, pero nunca tuvieron un gran público. Muchos de sus proyectos quedaron inacabados. Welles no consideró su regreso a Los Ángeles como una jubilación. De hecho, lo que quería era reconquistar Hollywood. En su equipaje de mano llevaba secuencias de una nueva película que quería terminar en Estados Unidos.
Tonight, the AFI spotlights a director, an actor, a writer, a producer, and here they are, Orson Welles!
What I feel this evening is not very clever. It's the very opposite of emptiness. The corny old phrase is the only one I know to say it. My heart is full. With a full heart, with all of it, I thank you. This honor I can only accept in the name of all the Mavericks. A Maverick may go his own way, but he doesn't think that it's the only way or ever claim that it's the best one, except maybe for himself. And don't imagine that this raggle-taggle gypsy-o is claiming to be free. It's just that some of the necessities to which I am a slave are different from yours. As a director, for instance, I pay myself out of my acting jobs.
I use my own work to subsidize my work. In other words, I'm crazy. But not crazy enough to pretend to be free. But it's a fact that many of the films you've seen tonight could never have been made otherwise. Or if otherwise, well, they might have been better, but certainly they wouldn't have been mine. The truth is, I don't believe that this great evening would ever have brightened my life if it weren't for this, my own particular contrariety. I leave you now in default of the eloquence this high occasion deserves with another very short scene from the same film, a piece of which you saw earlier with John Huston and Peter Bogdanovich, just by way of saying good night from one who will remember tonight, not as a sort of gala visit, but as a very happy homecoming, and who remains not only your obedient servant, but also in this age of supermarkets, your friendly neighborhood grocery store.
Welles mostró diferentes escenas de su última película, The Other Side of the Wind, su proyecto más ambicioso, para el tan importante como Ciudadano Kane.
Happy birthday, Jennifer!
Happy birthday!
I'm Marvin P. Fassbender.
Of course you are.
Mr. Hannaford's night. Let's save the questions for him, huh?
You two are very close, aren't you?
Yes, I'd like to ask you about that.
Why?
Come on, Hunter. Like, why do you think you have to
rude as you are, in print anyway.
I liked your last picture. No, I know that it was repetitive, but for what it was, it worked.
Yeah, well, she wasn't that kind to me in her review. Not that you did me too much harm. I mean, how much harm can you do to the third biggest grocer in movie history?
Really make that much? How marvelous.
Yes, did you know that when his own production company goes public, that your friend there stands to walk away with $40 million?
Yeah, she's going to say that I'm just going to keep on writing that I stole everything from you, Skipper. I'm never going to walk away from that.
Well, it's all right to borrow from each other. What we must never do is borrow from ourselves. Come on.
Of course you're close, you two. You have to be. You have no choice.
Please, dear lady, don't tell us what you mean by that.
Welles murió en Los Ángeles en 1985. The Other Side of the Wind no llegó a estrenarse. Aunque quedó prácticamente acabada, sigue bloqueada por problemas legales. Welles no consiguió volver a empezar. Su reputación de no ser capaz de acabar las películas quedó grabada a fuego para siempre. Algunos siempre han considerado su fama como un gran engaño. Otros le consideran un gigante caído. ¿Qué hizo en sus últimos años? Olla Kodar fue su musa y colaboradora durante sus últimos 20 años. Recibió como herencia un archivo personal repleto de películas y secuencias inéditas. Pero cuanto más dudaba Olla si hacerlas públicas, más rápido lo olvidaba el público.
Emocionalmente no estaba preparada para tocar nada del trabajo de Orson ni el nuestro. La gente dice, el tiempo lo cura todo. Pero yo tardé casi 10 años y aún no estoy completamente curada. Pero sí lo suficiente para demostrar a todo el mundo que Orson pasó trabajando los últimos 20 años de su vida. Normalmente dicen, ¿qué hizo en 20 años? Nada. Hacía anuncios, narraciones, pero en realidad nada serio. Y eso no es cierto.
El aura de la obra inacabada siempre ha planeado sobre Orson Welles. Solo terminó 12 películas, casi todas ellas cortadas, alteradas o mutiladas por sus productores. El Cuarto Mandamiento, Mr. Arcadin, Set de Mal. Casi ninguna de ellas pudo ser estrenada como Welles quería. Todos sus otros proyectos no han quedado más que en rumores, fragmentos, suposiciones.
Where'd she go? Where'd she go? Ma'am?
Hello? Ma'am? Oh,
oh, okay.
Oh. Bulb's burned out. Give me the flashlight, my man.
One movie? I think
that's about 10.
At least. It's
going to
be a lot of work.
Well, let's get
organized. Get the dolly, too.
Y cuando ustedes y los demás, cuando vean este material, verán cuánta juventud había en él. Cuánta energía. Cuánto disfrutaba. ¿Sabe? Todas aquellas cosas que él intentaba hacer y no podía, no le convirtieron en un viejo amargado. Además, era una persona a la que no le gustaba hablar del pasado y de las cosas que no habían funcionado. Siempre decía, las uvas agrias no son mi plato. A veces han sido más mi plato, pero nunca el suyo. Lo que quiero mostrarles es que era un hombre invencible, que tenía un coraje enorme y que nada podía impedirle que hiciera películas. Y a veces, en el fondo de mi corazón, yo deseaba que dejara de hacerlas. Porque simplemente en buscar dinero ya perdemos la mitad de la vida. Y eso fue lo que ocurrió. Él era un pintor muy bueno y un escritor maravilloso. Y si hubiera... Volvió a Hollywood con muchas energías, nuevas ideas, proyectos. No le disgustaba estar de nuevo en Hollywood, todo lo contrario. Y tenía muchas ofertas para hacer anuncios, narraciones. Y hacía aquello, como él decía, para pagar la bolsa de la compra.
Talking about money. Do you think if you'd had a great deal of it, it would have made your films better? Or did your poverty help your creativity in any way?
Did my poverty help my creativity? No. No. I think, however, that it is possible to spoil a young director by giving him too much money so that he does not learn one of the main arts of directing, which is the ability to walk away from something.
Does Orson Welles, the director, ever get in the way of Orson Welles, the writer, or how closely does one follow the other?
I think of it as a happy marriage. Seriously, no, I don't think so. I rewrite when I have an original script and it, Shakespeare, somebody didn't write it. I am rewriting all the time on the set.
How much obligation do you feel to a mass audience?
I would love to have a mass audience. You're looking at a man who's been searching for a mass audience. And if I had had one, I'd be obliged. That's all I can say.
This is a script of F of
Fate. Esto es un guión de F de Fraude. En realidad son notas de su puño y letra. Estas son las notas del tráiler de Fraude. Es la historia de... Realmente es un ensayo sobre la falsificación y los llamados expertos. Y Orson hizo el avance que veremos después. Es maravilloso, es realmente... La película trata sobre mentiras. Y el tráiler es una mentira en sí mismo.
Does she know more than she's telling?
Ladies and gentlemen...
Or is she telling more than she knows?
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked to provide a few words of explanation. Now, how shall I begin?
We're talking about movies. Begin with the director.
You ought to do that.
Modesty forbids.
Oh?
Well, we all know what the critics have said about the movie.
Our movie coming soon to this theater?
Delicious, delirious, delightful.
Go on.
I'm quoting the critics. They've acclaimed it as a cinematic...
I know one thing. I never offered a painting or a drawing to a museum who didn't buy it. That never refused one.
The author of the fake autobiography was also the author of a real biography about a faker, the great art faker, Elmire.
Great faker of the 20th century becomes a modern folk hero for the rest of us. Who have a bit of larceny in ourselves, but simply don't have the courage or the opportunity to express it.
The following commercial message, which is fairly brief and completely dishonest, concerns the advent soon on this same screen of the motion picture entitled F for Fake, which rips the veil of secrecy from a whole series of scandalous items.
For instance, the 22 Picassos. Worth who knows how many millions. How did this young woman get her hands on them?
Why did her grandfather soak them all in gasoline and burn them to ashes?
People wonder why it was so difficult to get permission to show this film in America.
They should remember that when F for Fake was playing to packed houses in the rest of the world, Howard Hughes was still alive.
Supposedly.
And if Kodar was carrying on with Picasso in the south of France, how did Hughes, who was busy at the time growing his toenails in Vancouver, make it to those secret meetings on the Mexican pyramid?
And what about the tiger? Who is under that sheet? By what strange chain of circumstances did this savage beast move from Managua to a penthouse swimming pool in Beloit, Wisconsin? And who is this man? CF for Fake, the movie that dares to ask that question.
The UFOs, Gary, we were going to mention. Remember that the unidentified flying objects only appeared after my radio broadcast?
And what about that flying object?
And here...
Ladies and gentlemen, suppose I come right out with it and admit to you now that my old Martian hoax on the radio was... well, not exactly... a hoax. That there were secret sponsors of that broadcast who were, in fact, some rather influential beings from outer space. You smile.
10 seconds more, Orson.
I think they're smiling, Gary, and I'd just like to remind them that it is since that broadcast that there have been in this country alone authenticated sightings. You still think it's a joke? Good. That's the way we want you to feel about it. For now.
We'd like to make this little commercial message as modest as possible. So we'll just say that critics all over the world have called it a masterpiece.
F. El tráiler de fraude fue rechazado por los distribuidores norteamericanos. Demasiado largo, demasiado extravagante.
Para él fue una decepción, porque quería explorar ese nuevo camino del ensayo cinematográfico. Pero como él decía, la caja de pinturas de un director de cine es demasiado cara, y por eso a veces, casi nunca, pero alguna vez, se lamentaba de no haber seguido pintando, aunque él se consideraba un pintor de segunda fila. Por ejemplo, ¿cómo ven los europeos a los turistas americanos? ¿O cómo mira el portero de un hotelucho francés a ese turista? Hablando de Francia, aquí hay un pequeño vagabundo francés. Yo guardaba muchos de sus dibujos, aunque Orson, como ya le he dicho, odiaba los recuerdos. Hacía unos garabatos y de repente hacía una bola de papel y la tiraba. Yo siempre estaba por ahí intentando salvar cosas, así que no tengo tantas como uno podría pensar. En 20 años podría haber acumulado tantas cosas. Orson Welles en la vida diaria. Bueno, no era en absoluto ese personaje sobrehumano que todo el mundo imagina. Detrás de su apariencia había modestia, incluso timidez. Él odiaba la imagen de megalómano que la gente tenía de él. Esta era su respuesta.
Héroe, trágico, megalómano. A menudo se le confundía con los personajes que tanto amaba. Disfrutaba jugando con esos clichés.
In England's green and pleasant land, few stately homes have entered the hectic hurly-burly of showbiz more recently than Plumfield Manor.
In opening your beautiful home to the public, Lord Plumfield, just what are your aims?
To give the tourist jolly good value for his money.
Do you feel you're keeping up with your competitors in the other stately homes?
Some of them all you get is a guided tour of the kitchen garden and a quick look at the family thumbscrew. Show we put on here is best the county.
Hello.
This is my son, Alger.
Ah. How do you do?
Hello. Gosh. Oh, I say, golly.
Golly, what, Alger?
Thank you, Peter. Another.
And there's my wife, the Countess. She's a great favorite of the tourists. She's a very fine dramatic recitation.
Ah, Lady Plumfield.
And if pushed, she'll take off her cardigan. There's the butler, Blemish.
Oh?
He does animal impressions. Do some of your animal impressions, Blemish. He says he doesn't want to. Pity. Temperamental old devil. I'd give him the sack, but we need the eggs.
You seem to be giving the tourists wonderful entertainment. It just seems a pity you're stuck out here in the country.
We're hoping to bring the show into town, just as soon as we can sell the house.
But then you'll have nowhere to live.
Oh, we don't live in the house. We live here. Would you care for a cup of tea?
Lord Plumfield versus Welles, un pequeño puzzle en dos partes y que mezcla dos épocas. Después de años, lo finalizó con nuevos planos de sí mismo como periodista. El escenario fue un pequeño jardín cerca de París. Esta casa fue su estudio durante varios años, un mini estudio de cine donde podía trabajar en sus proyectos en paz.
Scene 58, take one. Okay. Scene. The after deck. A fair morning. Tied up, twisted, eyes like coals still glowing in the ashes of a ruin, Ahab lifts up to the clearness of the morn his splintered helmet of a brow. This glad, this happy air, this winsome sky, at last seems almost to dissolve the canker wrinkle beating in his heart. The cruel stepmother world now throws affectionate arms around that stubborn neck. Old Ahab drops a tear into the sea. Not as the vast Pacific holds such wealth, as that one drop. Cut.
Es increíble que después de 20 años, después de que ocupantes ilegales arrasaran la casa, todavía hay rastros del trabajo de Orson. Siempre estaba trabajando en diferentes proyectos a la vez. De vez en cuando yo me iba un día o dos y al volver me enseñaba algo nuevo, como Moby Dick, por ejemplo. Empezó a rodarla con su propio dinero él solo, si no recuerdo mal, entre tomas de fraude. Una tarde simplemente le pidió al cámara que se quedase un rato más. Y así empezó.
Call me Ishmael. Some years ago, never mind how long, I thought that I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. Whenever I grow grim about the mouth and hazy in the eyes, whenever it's a damp November in my soul, I count it time to get to sea. Almost all men, sometime or other, cherish these same feelings toward the ocean. Why did the old Persians hold the ocean holy? And the still deeper meaning of that story of Narcissus, who, because he could not grasp the mild, tormenting image in the fountain, plunged into it and drowned. That same image we ourselves see in all rivers, in oceans and in lakes and wells. The image of the ungraspable, the phantom of life. And that is the key to it all.
Nadie sabe cuándo y por qué decidió Welles leer ciertos capítulos de Moby Dick. Los fragmentos aparecidos en los archivos de Oya no revelan ningún plan concreto. Evidentemente, Welles trabajaba en proyectos paralelos cuando tenía el tiempo y la inclinación.
Parece como un sótano de Xanadu, aunque Orson no era así en absoluto. Él no guardaba recuerdos. Yo diría que para él, las dos cosas más importantes, según decía, eran un buen par de zapatos y una buena máquina de escribir. Y debo añadir que había dos cosas más. Una es esta, una moviola de 16 milímetros que recorrió el mundo con nosotros. Y algo aún más precioso, al menos para mí, este baúl. Para mucha gente, los puros de Orson eran su marca distintiva, pero para mí era este baúl. Como él decía, contenía las herramientas de su profesión. Durante aquellos años viajábamos casi todo el tiempo y Orson quería tener la posibilidad de rodar en cualquier momento y en cualquier lugar. Durante meses viajamos con objetos de lo más insólito, con los que solía relacionar diferentes escenas, diferentes exteriores, proyectos. Al ver nuestro equipaje, la gente debía pensar que estábamos completamente locos.
Su vida creativa era la de un nómada. Se desarrollaba siguiendo las películas en las que actuaba. Los papeles no eran siempre los mejores, pero con lo que cobraba financiaba sus propios proyectos. En cuanto cobraba, aparecía en su propio plató. El director nómada viajaba con sus películas en la maleta. Dondequiera que captaba sus imágenes y motivos, una escena aquí, un plano allá, Allí estaba el plató de su mundo interior. Y así, a lo largo de los años, su obra fue formando un variado y atemporal tapiz. El artista de la improvisación llegaba hasta donde hiciera falta para extraer sus visiones del mundo. España fue más que una simple escala en sus viajes. Durante más de 30 años luchó por terminar su Don Quijote. Le apasionaban las corridas de toros más que cualquier otra cosa y mantuvo amistades con muchos toreros. Él también había probado suerte en la arena en su juventud y desde entonces nunca perdió la pasión por la fiesta. Viajar, filmar, viajar, un marco de ventana en un paisaje y de repente una nueva idea, un retrato humorístico de Churchill.
Sir, what are the desirable qualifications for a young man who wishes to become a politician?
The ability to foretell what is going to happen tomorrow, next week, next month, and next year. And to have the ability to explain afterwards why it didn't happen.
Mr. Churchill, what is it like to know that the hall will be packed to overflowing every time you make a political speech?
I always remember that if I was being hanged, the crowd would be twice as big. Hanging, if properly conducted, is, I believe, an absolutely painless death. Well, it may come to that.
Winston, I care neither for your politics nor your face.
Do not distress yourself, my dear. You are not likely to come into contact with either.
If you were my husband, I'd poison your coffee.
If you were my wife, I'd drink it.
Winston, you are drunk.
And you, my dear, are ugly. For tomorrow, I'll be sober.
This is a town for a sweet tooth. Sweet things to listen to. Sweet things to look at. And sweet things to eat.
Schwarzwälder Torte, Gugelhupf, Burgtheaterlinse, Topfenschnitten, Kaffeekremtorte, Nusstorte, Ebercreme, Italianschen, gemischte Cognacfrüchte, Streisel, Würfelgugel und Sackertorte.
When the world was young, I used to run riot in there. How sweet it was.
You know, there's an old English...
No, Irish. Irish proverb. And I'm not making this up, it's real. Beware of three things, it goes. Beware of three things. The wicked west wind, the potato blight, and the smile of an Englishman. Well, I'd like to amend that to the smile of an English tailor.
Do you mind standing naturally, sir?
I am standing naturally.
No. Are you really? Good gracious. Are we ready, Mr. Johnson?
Quite ready, Mr. Mapleton.
Eighteen.
16.
16.
11.5.
11.5.
7.75.
7.75. What is it?
Oh. No.
God bless my soul.
That's a good one, eh?
Make a note, Mr. Johnson. Right shoulder, 3 inches dropped.
My right shoulder?
Well, I can assure you, sir, no one else's.
3 inches?
Make that 3.5, Mr. Johnson.
14?
14.
And incredible, though, it
and
may seem.
And incredible, though, it may seem.
53.
53. 3 buttons. 1 to fasten, if possible. 1 breast pocket and 2 sides.
Now, I always like to have a pocket where...
I should advise you to leave the pocket situation to us, sir.
If you don't mind.
Certainly, sir.
18.
18.
9½.
9½.
3.
3.
Good Lord.
I notice we do not wear suspenders, sir. No doubt on account of our veins. Well, today is the 23rd of April. Shall we say the first fitting around about the 9th of December?
The 9th of December? Well, I...
This, I take it, sir, is a wallet.
A wallet?
This, sticking out at the back.
No, that's me.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'd never have mentioned it if I'd known. How very unfortunate for you.
Mr. Stewart, sir, we shall do everything we can in the most difficult circumstances imaginable. I suppose you'll be requiring this.
Off the peg, I take it.
And a most peculiarly shaped peg, sir, if I may say so.
Good morning, sir. Welles adoraba las historias y los cuentos, pero su propia vida dio lugar a leyendas escritas por otras manos que oscurecen su verdadera biografía. Se dice que un incendio destruyó su casa en España. Supuestamente allí perdió sus propiedades más preciadas, fotos, cartas, documentos e incluso películas inacabadas. Pero hasta la fecha, su casa de Madrid sigue intacta. La línea que separa la realidad de la fantasía es casi imperceptible. Las profundidades fue otro proyecto legendario cuya misma existencia se puso en duda a menudo. Con esta película de intriga autofinanciada, Welles quería llegar a un público más amplio.
Dear Chuck, the scene here might be useful for voiceover for the end of your introduction. Actually, the fire comes at the end of the picture. We're out in the Pacific Ocean. A newly wedded couple are here on their small yacht, cruising up the west coast of Africa on their way to the Mediterranean. Not a breath of air, so they're becalmed. To save gas, they're not using their auxiliary engine. Out in these waters, they might expect to be very much alone, but there's someone else out there. Another boat. Somebody is rowing over to them. The stranger has a very strange tale to tell. He's alone. Everyone else on that boat of his is dead.
Los papeles los interpretaron amigos. Oya Kodar, Jan Mogó, Michael Bryan y Lawrence Harvey. Como él estaba actuando en otra película en Dalmacia, el Adriático se convirtió en el Pacífico. Pero una vez más surgen problemas financieros. Es necesario posponer un año el final del rodaje.
Trapped there on a boat that's shipping water fast and ready to sink.
Johnny, help me! Please, Johnny!
And his young wife, trapped on their boat with a raving maniac.
Help!
What happened?
happens next. I'll have to leave that to the ticket buyers.
Finalmente, la muerte de Lawrence Harvey impidió que se terminara la película, aunque solo faltan unas pocas escenas. Más o menos en la misma época, en el Mediterráneo, Welles emprende un nuevo proyecto, El mercader de Venecia. Unas cuantas tomas del carnaval tuvieron que bastar para crear la atmósfera.
Look to my house. Go in. Lock up my doors.
El mercader de Venecia iba a ser una adaptación reducida de la obra para la televisión. La financiación estaba resuelta, pero Welles tuvo problemas con las autoridades fiscales. Los inversores se echaron atrás y Welles intentó acabarla él solo para no tener otra película incompleta entre las manos. Venecia, excesivamente cara, fue sustituida por un pequeño pueblo de la costa dálmata. El marco de ventana volvió a zarpar y unos muñecos de madera se convirtieron en los invitados enmascarados que esperan a Silovic.
Shylock, albeit I neither lend nor borrow, by taking nor by giving of excess, yet to supply the ripe want of my friend, I'll break a custom. Is he yet possessed how much he would?
3,000 ducats. It is a good round sum.
And for 3 months?
3 months from 12. Let me see, wait.
Well, Shylock, shall we be beholding to you?
Signor Antonio, many a time and oft on the Rialto, you have rated me about my manners and my usances. Still have I borne it with a patient shrug, for sufferance is the badge of all our tribe. You call me misbeliever, cutthroat, dog, and spit upon my Jewish gabardine, and all for the use of that which is my own. Go to them. You come to me and you say, Shylock.
Había finalizado el rodaje y el montaje iba a comenzar. Esta vez Welles había alcanzado su objetivo, pero entonces desaparecieron los negativos. El robo quedó sin resolver. Otra derrota, nuevas heridas. Años después Welles desempolvaría la cámara para rodar el monólogo de Silovic que no había llegado a hacer para su Mercader de Venecia.
He hath disgraced me. laughed at my losses, mocked at my gains, cooled my friends, heated mine enemies, scorned my nation. And what's his reason? I am a Jew. If not a Jew, hands. If not a Jew, eyes. Organs, dimensions, senses, affections, passions. Fed with the same food, heard with the same weapons. Subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means. Warmed and cooled by the same summer and winter. If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge? If we are like you in the rest, we will resemble you in that. The villainy you teach us, we will execute. It shall go hard, and I will better the instruction.
I was noticing continuity between the trial and a lot of your films dating back to Citizen Kane, as your view seems to be opposed to some of the best interests of the corporate elite, of which you speak directly about in the trial. And I was wondering if you thought your personal financial position as a film director is directly related to the fact that a lot of your views and your films throughout these ages have not exactly expressed their interests.
Would anybody like to answer that question?
Well, my personal opinion...
Good, stand up, let's hear it.
My personal opinion is that it's true, and that from the what I've read from your career, although I wasn't alive at the time you first were making films, that that you've had a tremendous problem with the press and corporate bureaucracy dating back, you know, since the earliest portions of your career, and that this is continuing today, and that's one of the reasons why you've been unable to finish some of your more recent projects.
Well, the only, there are only two main projects which are unfinished. One is The Other Side of the Wind, and when I tell you that my partner in that project is the brother-in-law of the late Shah of Iran, you will understand why we are having a little legal difficulty. The other unfinished film is Don Quixote, which was a private exercise of mine. And it will be finished as an author will finish it at my own good time, when I feel like it. It is not unfinished because of financial reasons. And when it is released, its title is going to be, When Are You Going to Finish Don Quixote?
Cuando le preguntaban por sus proyectos inacabados, Welles solía contestar con evasivas. La reputación de no acabar las películas le pesaba cada vez más. Cuando The Other Side of the Wind no pudo ser terminada, algunos vieron satisfechas sus expectativas. Siempre sería admirado como el hombre que hizo Ciudadano Kane, pero tan pronto como iniciaba nuevos proyectos, topaba con el rechazo.
Acepto lo que quiere decir con eso. No lo acepto si pensamos en un guión. Bueno, él lleva un guión a un estudio y este lo rechaza. En ese sentido había rechazo. Pero por lo demás sí, todo el mundo le aceptaba. Tenía muchos amigos, hizo muchos nuevos amigos, directores jóvenes, nuevos actores, disfrutaba mucho. Le encantaba estar con gente joven. Cuando hizo The Other Side of the Wind, el equipo estaba formado básicamente por gente muy joven, de 19 o 20 años. Una vez teníamos que rodar ciertas escenas de The Other Side of the Wind en un plató de verdad, pero no podíamos pagar lo que costaba. Así que elegimos un fin de semana, cuando sabíamos que no habría nadie trabajando. Entramos en el plató como estudiantes de cine, con Orson escondido en la furgoneta. Cada vez que pasaba un guardia, él se escondía. Pero aquella situación no le molestaba ni le resultaba frustrante. En realidad disfrutaba mucho engañándolos. Pero por supuesto, el engaño tenía que acabar el fin de semana. Así que estuvo en pie 48 horas mientras los cámaras se turnaban para dormir. Por supuesto que hubo decepciones y momentos tristes cuando Orson decía, los perros negros ladran a la puerta. Pero nunca les dejó entrar, apoderarse de nuestros estados de ánimo. Inmediatamente inventaba una nueva historia para ahuyentarlos. No se puede imaginar el teatro que tenía en mi salón. Se representaba todo Shakespeare. Él era un gran Romeo. Y le diré que también era una gran Julieta. Era tan divertido. Un día, viendo una filmación antigua llamada El hombre orquesta, en la que él interpretaba a todos los diferentes personajes, dijo, yo siempre he sido un hombre orquesta. Estaba pensando en hacer una película autobiográfica y ese iba a ser el título.
Thank you. Welcome to swinging London. I say this thing is on, isn't it?
The one man band is coming. Dig Morris beatbox of it. That's him. Drum, 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 and here comes the one man band.
The one man band is coming. Dig that music of it. That's me. Drum, 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 and here
comes the one man band. The one man band is coming. Here comes the one man band.
We continue our swinging tour with a visit to Carnaby Street, the mecca of the hep cats. This is not, in fact, Carnaby Street. This is somewhere else.
Up there is Father Ives beneath the bedclothes. And a funny little squeaker.
Well, this isn't actually our Carnaby Street, but I'm sure that...
Hear them tell him he's a shilling.
Now go away.
Back now among the bright lights of swinging London, the new play, playground of the international jet set.
Please buy my violets.
London. Wow, London, it's certainly changed in the last couple of years.
Violet, please buy my violets.
No, thank you.
Dirty postcards? Please buy my dirty postcards. Nice, filthy postcards.
What? Not just at the moment. Thank you very much. And now we're in the heart of London's clubland. Why don't we take a look in at one of these famous clubs? Take it away, baby.
You while I see pretty lady do split, please. I think acting is like sculpture. In other words, it's what you take away from yourself to reveal the truth of what you're doing that makes a performance. A performance, when it is, deserves to be considered great or important, is always entirely made up of the actor himself and entirely achieved by what he has left in the dressing room before he came out in front of the camera. There is no such thing as becoming another character by putting on a lot of makeup. You may need to put the makeup, but what you're really doing is undressing yourself and even tearing yourself apart and presenting to the public that part of you which corresponds to what you were playing. And there is a villain in each of us, a murderer in each of us, a fascist in each of us, a saint in each of us. And the actor is the man or woman who can eliminate from himself those things which will interfere with that truth.
Well, you do believe your eyes, don't you? And our cameras do not lie, really. They're seeing what you see without the slightest hint of technological trickery, sidearm snookery, hanky-panky, or ranny gazoo.
Magic. It's has an innocence that appeals to me. It's a return to childhood. It renews the sense of on a certain level. It's like playing with toys. It's pure play. And sometimes it can be a little more than that. It can have a kind of second-rate poetry that I find attractive. Great magic, you know. There's a moment when you suspend disbelief and it becomes a very good kind of theater. We actors pretend to be modest, you know? But no magician is modest. Every magician is the greatest magician in the world.
Nobody is completely grown up, and no work of art... God, what a terrible thing have I said. No movie is made by a complete adult, you know. First of all, I don't know any complete adults in civilian life, so how could they have infiltrated movies, you know? It's unthinkable, seems to me.
Listen, I was preparing for the show, you know?
Yeah.
And I hired my writer, Gags Beasley.
Not Gags Beasley.
Gags Beasley.
Oh,
the
dear.
Ace comedy writer for 57 years in this business. He has given me the A material for the Orson Welles show.
The cheapest comedy writer that there's going.
Are you kidding? Terrible. I'm paying him $1.50 a joke.
$1.50 a joke?
$1.50, yes. You called that cheap?
You should pay him by the laugh.
Well, he could never get paid then.
That's right.
I feel it's my moral obligation to censor all the sick, perverted ideas on that disgusting program. How do you do, Mr. Welles? And I must say, I am shocked at you.
Why?
Having this low comedy from this bear and this frog who allows it to happen, having this on your show, I'm absolutely shocked, a man of your stature.
No, I like this form of television because it's about people. That's my favorite subject. And it belongs uniquely to the tube. A talk show wouldn't work. It simply couldn't happen on a movie screen or a stage. And for me, that makes it irresistible. Television is the one theater I've never really worked in. All right, a pause for some commercial messages. We'll be right back. Well, it's true I have
several professions. I write and direct and act in motion pictures and in plays. I also do magic. We say the magic word.
Nika.
And here, here's something I always enjoy. Nika whiskey. It's easy to enjoy.
Pruebas para un anuncio de whisky escocés. Welles vendió su voz, su rostro, su mito o simplemente a sí mismo. Era parte de su estrategia de autofinanciación, pero el público lo vio como la aceptación final de su fracaso.
Él lo consideraba un negocio, no era cínico. Reescribía el texto, intentaba hacerlo lo mejor que podía. Era muy profesional en todo lo que hacía.
Trabajar para poder meterse en lo suyo era el precio de la independencia, o como él decía, esa contrariedad particular suya. Eso no cambiaría durante aquellos últimos años en Hollywood. De repente se enciende una luz en la fábrica de sueños. Welles y Oya emprenden un nuevo proyecto basado en dos novelas de su escritora favorita, Tania Blixen.
Isaac Dinesen was a Dane who wrote under that name. And I've been in love with her since I opened her first book. In life, she was the Baroness Blixen, and to her close friends, she was Tanya. One day, I took a plane to Copenhagen to visit her. She was living then in the same old house where she was born, where she died. I had friends who knew her well and who would drive me there next morning. I spent a sleepless night, and at daybreak, I took the first plane out of Denmark. What could a casual, an uninvited visitor have presumed to offer except his stammered thanks? The visitor would be a bore. And the lover was too humble and too proud for that.
Desde luego no llegó a conocerla, pero amaba su talento. Estaba absolutamente, como él decía, enamorado de aquella mujer. En cuanto terminó el guión, Orson empezó con la producción, como siempre con su propio dinero. Nuestra casa cerca de Hollywood Boulevard se transformó en una villa del siglo XIX en Milán. Trabajábamos en secreto absoluto, porque sabíamos que en aquellas condiciones el rodaje podía durar años, y él temía que volvieran a acusarle de no terminar la película a tiempo.
This was the first thing Pellegrino ever wished for, a little white villa in Milan. It was her first possession. This house will always be here, awaiting the return of Pellegrino. Pellegrino says, before that happens, weeds will break through that piano. In any case, you'll never hear me speak that name again.
You'll never hear her speak to you again.
More energy.
You'll never hear her speak to you again.
More must speak, slower.
Okay. You'll never hear her speak to you again.
You're entering the continent.
You'll never hear her speak to you again.
That's good. Ah, I can start away. Now stop and laugh.
She laughs. Behold, the miracle. She laughs. Take me along with you, and soon we shall see more of them. It is true, then?
Yes.
Alone, like this? And in the dead of night?
Pellegrino's dead. Even the servants think so. I had no chance to say goodbye. Will you do that for me?
It is struck midnight.
The dawn of a new day. At dawn, Luigi will be working in the garden here. Please don't forget Luigi.
I will say goodbye for you. I do not ask where you are bound for.
Many places.
Little lioness, you will need money.
I will earn my money, whoever I will be. Marcus, I will be many persons.
Let this go with you, little lioness. I should like you to be easy. This ring will carry you left or right in all of your directions.
Left or right, Marcus, but never home again.
Not ever.
Oh, here's something.
Aquí hay algo que quiero que vea.
I'd like you to see.
Ve, Orson lo hacía todo él mismo. Él diseñó estos escenarios. Esto iba a ser para el monasterio de los soñadores, para la escena en la que muere Pellegrina.
¿Y también eran para hacer el monólogo?
Sí, en realidad filmamos el monólogo en nuestra casa. Pero él pensaba rodar los planos más largos en un monasterio de verdad. Bueno, un monasterio falso. Pero construido a tamaño natural, por así decirlo.
Pellegrina Leoni fracasa finalmente en el intento de vivir varias vidas a la vez. Welles interpretó a Marcus, que va a recogerla después de su muerte.
Now that you've cornered her, killed her, you want the truth. Pellegrina, Leone, the prima donna assoluta, had in her life two great devouring passions. And what was the first of these? It was for Pellegrina. She was a devil to the other women in the opera. It was a terrible and jealous love. And this other passion, it was not for me, young gentleman. No, I was, for the first half of my life, just such an unhappy young man as you are. I was rich and traveled much. I kept my own court of ballet to perform before me and my friends, or before me alone. I had 30 young girls who used to dance before me naked. And I was bored to death, young gentleman. I might well have died of boredom had I not happened to hear a small theater stage in Venice. The voice of Pellegrina Leone. Then I understood. I understood the meaning of heaven and earth, and the stars, life and death and eternity. She took you out into a rose garden filled with nightingales, and then lifted you up with her, higher than the moon.
Los soñadores no pasó de ser un sueño, una visión nebulosa de la que solo se rodaron unas pocas escenas y que parecían resumirlo todo para Welles en las últimas palabras del guión. Solo hay dos preguntas que puede hacerse una persona inteligente. ¿Qué pretendía Dios cuando creó el mundo? Y ¿ahora qué hago? Siguió desarrollando nuevos proyectos. El Gran Anillo de Cobre estaba ambientada en la arena política norteamericana. Los inversores querían estrellas, pero no se pudo llegar a ningún acuerdo con los actores. Se mecerá la cuna, basada en un antiguo texto teatral. La financiación se hundió. El Rey Lear no llegó a materializarse por las falsas promesas de los productores franceses. Era una decepción tras otra. Ewells encendió un puro y volvió a la magia.
Enough. She can't endure it for much longer. With the speed of light, Laila was transported through a time warp from the ancient past. Time now for her return. Directing your attention to an improbability in the future tense. You have witnessed her materialization, her penetration, now vaporization.
Evaporation.
I am a profound pessimist. With a sentimental inclination to hope that Pangloss was right and that I'm wrong. I have a sentimental inclination toward hope. I believe in bravery and worship it. To me, it's one of the greatest virtues there are. And the fact that I'm a pessimist is part of what gives bravery such an importance to me. Don't call me a macho. That's not what I'm talking about.
Ahab is forever Ahab, man. I am the fate's lieutenant under orders. You see an old man cut down to the stump, leaning on a shivered lance, propped on a lonely foot. It is Ahab. Ahab's body's part. But Ahab's soul's a centipede that moves upon 100 legs. You see me strained, half-stranded as ropes that tow dismasted frigates in a gale. But ere I'll break, you'll hear me crack. Till you hear that, no Ahab's hawser tows his purpose yet.
Cuando Orson Welles era joven, oyó a un anciano chino decir: cuidado con la luna creciente, es tan frágil que tu mirada debe ser pura, de lo contrario te verás condenado a la desgracia. Él mismo recordaba esta escena a menudo en sus últimos años. Quizá en alguna ocasión había desoído el consejo.
I am very, very, I hate to use the word superstitious because I take it more seriously. I'm awfully serious about the moon. I think the Robert Graves was right when he said that the most blasphemous thing that has happened since Alexander cut the Gordian knot was when we landed on the moon. And having let loose with a piece of eccentricity of that kind, you'll see who you're dealing with.
Y The Other Side of the Wind. En los archivos de Oya no hay más que breves fragmentos de su última obra maestra. Welles pretendía hacer una película de 3 horas a partir de ellos. Los problemas legales siguen manteniendo la película bloqueada actualmente y puede que para siempre.
El productor obligó a Orson a enviar la película a Francia y una vez más él intentó por todos los medios terminarla, improvisando nuestro jardín de Orvilliers. Orson siempre utilizaba muy poca gente para sus trabajos y teníamos como a 5 o 6 personas cuando rodamos esta escena. Orson, su cámara, 2 ayudantes, nuestra productora, Dominique Antoine y el contable de Orson. Dominique Antoine se encargaba de hacer los semáforos del principio. Cambiaba las luces de verde a rojo y todo eso. Y teníamos 2 ayudantes. Ellas eran responsables de la lluvia y esta se hacía con 2 mangueras de jardín. Fue realmente divertido. Si alguien nos hubiera visto en aquel momento, habría pensado, ¿qué demonios está haciendo esa gente?
Más adelante, Welles escribiría: aquella película no consiguió estrenarse. Para mí, profesionalmente, aquel fracaso fue mortal. En Los Ángeles todo el mundo habla de ese loco de Welles. A los 62 años no es fácil hacer planes para volver a empezar. Pero en este negocio ridículo aprendemos a mantenernos a base de esperanza y entusiasmo.
70K6. Help me up, man. Let me stand. So. I'm off there. What do you see? I've oversailed him. Huh? Got the start. He's chasing me. And not I him. For any missing. Just little Pip. Just Pip. A bad beginning, say, a bad omen. Omen. If the gods would speak to man, they'll speak outright. Not shake their heads and give an old wife's darkling hint. Hands off, you tour of mankind! Old Ahab stands alone among the millions of the peopled earth. Nor gods nor men his neighbors. Cut no good. Moby Dick!
70, Moby Dick.
I'm off there. What do you see? I've oversailed him. Forgot the start. He's chasing me. Not I him. Any missing? Huh? Just little Pip. Huh? A bad beginning, say. A bad omen. Omen. If the gods would speak to man, they'll speak outright. Not shake their heads and give an old wife's darkling hint. Hands off, you tour of mankind. Old Ahab stands alone among the millions of the peopled earth. Nor gods nor men his neighbors. No! We're off there, what do you see? Gray shopper, crowder into the wind's eye.
There are never many, never enough of them, but there are men born into the world with a gaze fixed on the widest possible horizon. Men who can see without strain beyond the most distant horizon into that unconquered country we call the future. This is Orson Welles, remaining as always, obediently yours.
Oh, how I did it! Mastery of the cinema.
Thank you.